Good afternoon, thank you all for coming. I'm hoping to begin a dialogue here in a new area for our department. So today I'm going to talk about a new course in the Department of Spanish and Portuguese titled Health and Healing in Hispanic Literature. If approved by the Faculty Senate, the faculty in the department has already approved it, this class will become a second choice for students to fulfill the same requirement that is currently fulfilled with Spanish 307, Introduction to Hispanic Literature. So what I'm going to talk about today is why I think this very small curricular change could be a big deal. At the core, what is exciting about this course is that it bridges two disciplines across a significant institutional divide. On the one side, the course engages a humanistic approach to literary and other cultural texts by studying them as aesthetic and social phenomena. On the other, it engages the concerns of medical and health educators who seek to rehumanize the patient-provider relationships by developing their students' narrative experience, narrative competence, and especially their attention to, representation of, and affiliation with their patients. Attention and representation are what narrative medicine proponents call two movements that spiral together to form affiliation. A health provider's capacity for attention, representation, and affiliation are fed and shaped by training in the close reading of literary and artistic texts. And I'm going to give lots of examples, so we're going to come back to this spiral. In the context of falling university enrollments generally, and relatively larger losses in enrollments in literature classes specifically, this approach to literary study might realize a gain for humanistic studies and for humanities enrollment. At the same time, health and healing in Hispanic literature offers a vital experience for the increasing number of students who complete a second major rather than a first major in literature or linguistics while they prepare for a career in health or social work. Mm-hmm. And while this course specifically contextualizes literature within discourses of health and illness, there are also implications for curricular change that relate to other professional areas, where educational leaders increasingly recognize the loss of humanistic preparation among their students and the resulting losses of professionalization and leadership. And this includes educational leaders in business, law, law enforcement, and to some extent the STEM fields. Health and healing in Hispanic literature is informed by a convergence of factors. First, my conversations with my colleague, Doctora Veronica Plaza, who has led the Medical Spanish Initiative in the Department of Spanish and Portuguese that began in 2008, and the concurrent growth in the numbers of Spanish second majors who have declared a major in health sciences. Second, this course is informed by the international movement in medical or health humanities, and third, by narrative medicine. So let me characterize each of these three elements. First, medical Spanish at UNM and student enrollments. My ongoing conversations with Dr. Plaza regarding the medical Spanish classes led me a year and a half ago to investigate enrollments in Spanish at UNM. While undergraduate enrollment at UNM in general has decreased by about 10% over the past 7 years, enrollment in upper-level Spanish classes has decreased even more, by about 13%. Over the same period, enrollments at UNM in foreign languages and literatures, as well as in English, have also fallen, more than the university average. I do want to recognize that there's a debate about whether this kind of downward direction is a long-term direction or whether it's just a blip. Because if you look at enrollments in humanities over the past 30 years, there are ups and downs, but they're pretty steady. Interestingly, while the number of students completing a first major or minor in Spanish, and those are the blue and the green lines at the bottom, have fallen notably over the past 5 years, the number of students enrolling in the second major in Spanish, the red line, has increased in the same time. The increase in second majors in relation to first majors seems to parallel a national trend, although the available national data are not up to date. You see that ends in 2013. Here you see an increase in the number of second majors in Spanish, in red, and in all foreign languages in blue as a percentage of first majors. At UNM it looks very different because here you see, say, 30% to 50%. Well, we have many more second majors than first years, than first majors. But there is a clear increase in that second major movement over the 13 years of data shown. In spring 2015 at UNM, 90% of the graduates in Spanish and Portuguese were second majors or minors, not first majors. And about, I went backwards, not forward. And about half of our Spanish second majors and minors have a first major in the health sciences, mm-hmm. as you can see in the top line of these data from 2016. Now, this is second majors or minors, but again, our first majors are a much smaller group. This is who our students are here at UNM. The vast majority of these students are either heritage or native speakers of Spanish. Many see Spanish language, literature, and culture not as an end in itself, not as a preparation for teaching or for graduate study in literature or linguistics, but in relation to their heritage and as the context in which they will develop their career. Second, in influencing this course is the movement in medical humanities, now being called health humanities, to signal a broader inclusionary movement. Health humanities has its beginnings in the mid-20th century within medical education at the time when diagnosis was becoming increasingly a matter of technological and laboratory testing, and medical professionals saw the weakening of the patient-provider communication as part of diagnosis and treatment. So this is when technical advances, scientific advances, were making the patient into a body to be examined rather than into a human being. While the field of health humanities is still difficult to define precisely, academic programs usually focus on the cultural and social construction of bioscience, also on ethics related to science and healthcare, and finally on the role of empathy, both in relation to science and in relation to healthcare. According to this recent report by Barry Lamon Jones, there are 66 undergraduate programs in health humanities in the United States today, including majors, minors, and certificates. And we, our BAMD program is, I don't know if they count it here, but it's similar. These programs seek to develop, according to this report, quote, students who are patient-centered, ethically intelligent, skilled in communication, and competent with diverse populations. These programs are located in different places in the institution. They are often interdisciplinary programs within the College of Arts and Sciences or the College of Liberal Arts. Sometimes they're hosted within a single department. Those departments might be philosophy, comparative literature, English. Those are the primary ones. And the programs bring together with the health sciences studies in literature, philosophy, history, political science, sociology, anthropology. Many of these programs recommend that students take courses in medical Spanish, but while most offer courses in health and literature, these courses focus on English language literature or world literature in English. I have only identified nationally so far five courses that integrate Hispanic literature and health studies at the university level. Here is an institutional opportunity for departments of Spanish and Portuguese, especially, and for departments of foreign language generally. The third influence on this course is narrative medicine, particularly the work coming out of Dr. Rita Sharon's program at Columbia University. The approaches to literary study promoted by narrative medicine intersect with those that we value as humanists. Dr. Rita Sharon, who is an internist and professor of clinical medicine, founded the program in narrative medicine in the year 2000 after she, already being a medical doctor, went and got a PhD in English and wrote her dissertation on Henry James and the role of literature in medicine. At Columbia, she and an interdisciplinary team that includes a creative writer, an artist, a literary scholar, an ethicist, as well as scholars in medical anthropology, psychiatry, medicine, and social work, are transforming medical education and patient-provider relationships by developing students' narrative competence. The goals of narrative medicine find support in cognitive and social psychological research. Keith Oatley, David Comer Kidd, and Emmanuel Castaño have produced experimental research that links the reading of literary fiction, and especially what they term as, they distinguish between literary and genre fiction. So they're not talking about, say, detective novels or Harry Potter, but kind of a more canonical literary fiction. They relate the reading of literary fiction positively to empathy and to theory of mind. Theory of mind is the human ability to perceive and understand the emotions, beliefs, and intentions of other human beings. Medical educators also agree with literary scholars in pointing out some of the big picture critical thinking that comes from the study of literature, that studying literature can help us to develop a moral imagination, that it can help us to see the human condition in a larger context, and to question conventional thinking and assumptions within the profession. Humanists have allies within medical education, educators who also believe that studying literature helps us to approach humanity with a heightened appreciation for an ability to work with its complexity and its ambiguity. In spring of this year, 2017, 22 students enrolled in my pilot course, La Vida, La Literatura y el Poder de la Lectura. 9 of the 22 students, 41%, were health sciences majors. 9 majored in social sciences, architecture, engineering, environmental sciences. Only 3 were humanities majors, and 1 was undecided. I organized the texts in the course around the concerns of health and healthcare, narrative medicine, culture and health, the body and poetry, illness and medicine, power and ethics, barriers to access to medical care, disability, and end of life. If these course unit titles respond primarily to the concerns of pre-professional preparation in health fields, the goals and learning outcomes reveal the course's humanistic focus, and they include the following. Students will analyze the meanings and effects that texts stimulate, applying concepts of formal analysis, explaining how texts give pleasure, how they communicate ideas, emotions and effects, and how they move readers with their vision of humanity. That's what you would find on any 307 syllabus or something like that. Students will develop their moral imagination and an experience of embodied reading, imagining the bodily experience of the other. Students will understand that human beings create concepts of health and illness through language, and that those concepts are molded by culture and history. Students will appreciate the relationship between close reading and the capacity to listen to another human being and to collaborate with them, especially in relationship to health. And as I always do in Spanish 307, I made students memorize terminology, metaphors, metonymy, synecdoche, tested them throughout the semester. So the primary focus was on how do we do this close reading. We began the course listening to a TED talk about honoring the stories of illness given in 2011 in Atlanta by Dr. Rita Sharon of Columbia University, and by reading about narrative medicine and its focus on narrative competence, which Sharon describes as the ability to, quote, recognize, absorb, metabolize, interpret, and be moved by the stories of illness. These texts articulate the professional side of the divide that the course seeks to bridge. Soon, we were deep into reading the 15th century of Romance del Infante Vengador, Garcilaso's Soneto 23, poems by Alfonsina Storni, Alejandra Pizarnik, stories by Augusto Monterroso, Gabriel García Márquez, and Juan Rulfo, and theater by Luis Quiñones de Benavente and Sabina Berna. Texts familiar to any introductory course to Hispanic literature. The focus on health and medicine even eased us out of some of the canonical straitjackets that texts often give us, so we could read less frequently read gems, such as Pablo Neruda's Oda al Laboratorista, Ode to the Laboratory Technician, and Gabriela Mistral's Vieja, where she talks a lot about wrinkles. We recontextualize this imaginative fiction within broader discourses of health, illness, and medicine. We listened to songs, we read newspaper articles and blogs, testimonies of a witchcraft trial, the narrative of a 60-year-old Spanish man with kidney failure and oral testimony, a chapter from Jorge Pérez Ávila's memoir, Sida, Confesiones al Médico, and we watched films including María Sabina, Gaby, A True Story, and Mar Adentro. These other discourses we also analyzed with care for their perspectives, their figurative language, their narrative structure. I have always loved teaching the Intro to Hispanic Literature course. I've loved it. And we've used the book Aproximaciones al Estudio de la Literatura Hispánica for at least the 17 years that I've been at UNM. But this pilot course was, for me, much more exciting, much more meaningful, and the class dynamics were very positive. I'm going to show you now, or read to you, a few of the samples of students' work, and you can see the ways in which this approach integrates close reading, formal analysis, and an awareness of the social function of cultural texts that is enhanced by their contextualization with the concerns of healthcare. And all the students whose work I quote have given me permission. We read the Argentine poet Alejandra Pizarnik's El Despertar in a unit on disability and in dialogue with a recent article on mental illness as disability from the Argentine newspaper La Nación. One student chose these verses from El Despertar as the focus of that day's reading journal reflection. ¿Cómo no me suicido frente a un espejo y desaparezco para reaparecer en el mar donde un gran barco me esperaría con las luces encendidas? I'm so sorry. La actitud principal en estos versos, the student wrote, es una que incluye la melancolía y la tristeza. So as you listen, listen for the formal analysis, for the depth of engagement, and for contextualization. Se presentan emociones bastante fuertes que demuestran la muerte y lo que sucede después de la muerte. En este fragmento yo encontré el símbolo muy presente. Cuando dice, donde un gran barco me esperaría con las luces encendidas, se puede ver que el barco representa lo que viene después de la muerte. Es como si las luces del barco representan el ir al otro mundo donde hay luz, y la luz representa la paz y tranquilidad. Se usa el barco para esconder la idea de que la muerte en realidad sí puede suceder. De alguna manera, el lenguaje demuestra un llamado. Tal vez sea de ayuda para la persona que lo escribió. Es una pregunta retórica que está dando la idea de que algo malo puede suceder. También se habla de poder ver las luces, que se relaciona con el no poder ver nada, estar ciega. Se nota que la persona que escribió esto tenía en mente usar la pregunta para llamar la atención en esta estrofa y demostrar su importancia al comparar la muerte con algo tan grande como un barco. Se comparan el barco y la muerte, demostrando la grandeza y el impacto que tiene cada uno. Y a la misma vez enseñando que después de la muerte ya no tendrá discapacidades, porque podrá ver las luces del barco, podrá ver todo. The student develops a complex and, in places, problematic reflection on the meaning of the ship and its lights. The ship itself is both a means to hide the reality of death, named the death that's named in the line, como no me suicido, and it is also an image conveying the immensity of death and its impact. There's some contradiction there. The writer attains greater coherence when they discuss the ship's lights, which represent what the poet will experience beyond death. These lights suggest the peace and tranquility that might be achieved through death after the poet has left mental illness behind. The student writer has difficulty finding the words and the syntax to express the next complicated idea, that the ship's lights, in suggesting the clarity of vision and comprehension that the poet may attain in death, also evoke their opposite, the inability to see, or the blindness the poet has experienced in lifelong mental and emotional struggles. While the expression of these ideas by the student is linguistically fraught and reveals unaddressed contradictions, it also shows intense critical thinking and motivated engagement to interpret a challenging poem and its complex symbolic imagery. The intensity of the struggle speaks to of a rich learning experience, perhaps enhanced or illuminated by the contextualizing of the poem in relationship to a journalistic treatment of mental illness as disability, and because of the interest level that representations of health issues, and particularly suicide, have for young adults. For the final paper, a different student chose to write about the Dominican singer-songwriter Juan Luis Guerra's song and music video, El Niagara en Bicicleta. We had studied the song briefly in a unit on barriers to access to medical care. Again, the analysis brings together a sharp awareness of the social function of cultural texts with an in-depth exploration of form, in this case, the satire, created through hyperbole, and the unusual images that communicate a sense of chaos. Juan Luis Guerra usa la sátira para tratar el tema del sistema de la salud en la República Dominicana, criticando la falta de recursos en el área de la medicina por causa de la pobreza. El poeta crea imágenes muy vívidas e irregulares para que el lector tenga una idea en mente de qué tan grande es este problema en los hospitales. And as you listen, remember, this is a third year student. This is intro to Hispanic Lit. Los recursos más simples que tiene un hospital son usados para satisfacer otras necesidades que no sean las de curar a los pacientes, dejando así a los pacientes sin atención médica. Acciones dramáticas hechas por los médicos son presentadas para describir que tienen un carácter temerario cuando se trata sobre su poder en la distribución de los recursos médicos. En las frases de hipérbole, no me digan que el alcohol se lo bebieron, y que el suero se usó para endulzar el café, los médicos egoísticamente usan los pocos recursos médicos para sus propias satisfacciones sin que les importen las consecuencias, tales como que esos recursos se acaben. La imagen del estetoscopio que anda de fiesta se puede ver como una personificación, pero todavía cae bajo las acciones exageradas para añadir a los efectos del mundo caótico del hospital.
I just want to make a comment right there, because I think part of that portrayed in that is the physician, the ones that are taking the resources, is a misunderstanding
of the
cultural context of Latin America. Because if anyone have been in a public hospital in Latin America, the providers do miracles with nothing, and the providers are not the ones that are taking you know, outweigh the resources. That's a political context. So I think there's completely a disconnection there of lack of understanding of the cultural context.
And then,
you know, allow that the providers, you know, are the ones that are doing that, as that's not the, you know, I don't think that that's realistic. Because if anyone have worked in a public hospital in Latin America, or in the Caribbean, or visit, or seen what providers do with nothing, I take it as an insult.
So that, I mean, that's also part of the point here, is that these texts then become the basis for classroom discussions where you talk about then, why is it that Guerra constructs it in this way, and what discourses is he
But if a student write up that if the doctor that do that, the class discussions didn't address the cultural context.
Right. Well, but I'm saying, you know, because Juan Luis Guerra is doing it in that way, so then we have to discuss why is he portraying it in that way. La oración porque es muy duro, pasar el Niagara en bicicleta es el gancho de la canción, y la hipérbole más importante porque demuestra cómo los hospitales no hacen su trabajo, haciendo que el protagonista quiera hacer lo imposible como ellos. These student examples show the development of attention, the first of the two movements of narrative medicine, attention and representation, which lead to affiliation. They also represent the kind of close reading that we want our students to do in the humanities. The students also practice representation in this class, transferring their close attention in reading to their attention to a live health narrative. They interviewed an acquaintance or relative. They interviewed an acquaintance or relative about in Spanish about a health experience. I wish I could read you all of their narratives. I found them moving, shaped in ways that engaged the reader and attentive and respectful to their informants. Many of the students were able to understand in their interviews and express in their narratives the embodied experience of emotion in the face of a dramatic health incident. In a narrative titled Los Años No Pasan en Vano, a student narrates a pre-heart attack experienced by that student's abuelo. Abuelo is the first to speak, addressing his wife. Margot, mi hija, no me siento bien. Ay, negro, ¿qué tienes? Tengo un dolor aquí en el pecho, lo siento como apretado. Ay, Dios mío, ¿no será un infarto? Vamos para la policlínica, vamos, vamos, vamos. Entre gritos y llanto, Margot salió corriendo del cuarto a buscar a cualquiera de sus hijos o a quien estuviese en la casa para ir a la policlínica en el carro. Sentía cómo se apoderaba de ella un frío que lo sentía hasta en la boca del estómago. Juanita, su tía, que vivía al lado, observaba temblando de los nervios a través de las rejas que dividían ambas casas los sucesos que se desarrollaban. Se hacía de ellas tan fuertemente para mantenerse en pie que se enrojecían las manos. Asimismo, una multitud de personas, tanto familiares como vecinos, se reunía en la puerta de la casa para enterarse de lo que sucedía. Entre ellos cuchicheaban sobre lo sucedido, y en sus caras se veía el horror de la imagen que se llevaron al ver el cuerpo inerte de Emmanuel en el carro. In writing this narrative, the student demonstrates a developing creative awareness of the elements of effective narrative, as well as empathy for the human beings involved in this situation. Several students expressed ways in which the interview and narrative representation affected their perception of or relationship with the person they interviewed. One had a hard time approaching a relative to talk even after the relative had given consent because the student sensed empathetically the relative's hesitance. Another struggled with his own attitudes towards his father's lack of self-care and his own inability as a son to say anything that would change his father's behavior. It would be overreaching to call this a new affiliation developed through attention and representation, since most of the students interviewed family members with whom they already had lifelong relationships. However, the students' changing feelings and the perceptions of the interviewees speak to the power of attention and representation to enrich affiliation. Here is what one student concluded. Nunca imaginé que el hacerle una entrevista a mi madre sería tan emocional para ambas. Hubo momentos muy tristes en los que lloramos las dos y momentos de asombro, ya que había algunas cosas que yo no sabía o no recordaba sobre su enfermedad. También era muy impactante recordar y ver qué tan fuerte ha sido mi madre durante toda su vida. Narrative competence is this, the ability to recognize, absorb, metabolize, interpret, and be moved by stories of illness. So if reading literary fiction can work these human transformations, how do we engage students who are second majors and minors and who may see their studies of Spanish primarily as a means to an end and convince them to extend their engagement with literature beyond the introductory class? In his book, The Crafty Reader, the literary critic Robert Scholes calls on teacher scholars to engage students through helping them connect literary texts with the human interests and impulses that make them meaningful to us. Recent research on reading motivation by scholars of both first and second language reading supports this idea in showing that readers' intrinsic motivation, correlates positively to readers' desire to spend more time reading, to persist when reading is challenging, and to become more self-determined in their reading. The same correlation is not found for extrinsic motivation, such as earning grades or competing with classmates. Wigfield and Guthrie's Motivation for Reading questionnaire has led researchers to focus on 8 motivational factors, 3 of which they identify as intrinsic motivation: curiosity about the text, emotional involvement or pleasure in the text, and a preference for the mastery of challenge of reading, wanting to master what's in the reading. When readers find intrinsic motivation to read, they are more likely to understand the text conceptually and to want to learn the material for its own sake. Intrinsic motivation also relates positively to increased amounts of reading, which in turn also correlates to increased reading comprehension. There is at least one second language study that finds a correlation between reading comprehension and one extrinsic motivating factor of instrumentalism, specifically the learner's perception that he or she will gain practical advantages such as career opportunities from learning the second language. So one of the underlying assumptions of the Health and Healing in Hispanic Literature course is that it is important to take into account our students' reading motivation, especially in required courses, which offer special opportunities to romance our students into the world of literature and into the value of literature to their own lives and career aspirations. So how well did this new course stimulate my own students' reading motivation? I built a research project around a modified Wigfield and Guthrie reading motivation questionnaire and administered it to the class, comparing my health-focused section to 2 other Spanish 307 sections taught by gifted and well-loved instructors. My hypothesis was that by attending to students' intrinsic motivation first, rather than giving priority in the course organization to the canonical approach to literary texts represented in Aproximaciones, students' intrinsic motivation to read would increase. The survey results are mostly inconclusive, although my analysis of them is suggestive enough that I'm continuing the research. I administered the survey in the 9th week of the 16-week semester. The survey consisted of 38 reading motivation and reading compliance items and 7 demographic questions. Participants used a 5-point Likert scale, that is strongly agree, agree, undecided, disagree, strongly disagree, to respond to a series of statements. And I'm going to show you the results just for the 3 intrinsic motivation factors of curiosity, involvement, and preference for a challenge, as well as one question regarding specific extrinsic motivation, specifically instrumentality. In the results, on the advice of a linguistics colleague, I've collapsed the 5-point Likert scale into a 3-point scale of agree, undecided, and disagree.
How do you define instrumentality?
Instrumentality here meaning that I'm reading literature in order to gain something else
practical
from it, something practical from this reading. 66 students were invited to take the survey, but because the survey was not required for, the completion of the survey was not required in the course, this led to a relatively small number of subjects, which is one of the reasons that the research is inconclusive. A total of 31 students responded, 11 students from the health section, which is 55% of that section, and 8 and 12 students respectively from the strictly literature sections. So that was an average of 43.5% of those sections. You will see that for every reading motivation factor, the respondents from the health focus section did score higher, a higher response than those from the literature only sections. However, when I applied a statistical test, the Kruskal-Wallis H test in SPSS on the data, the difference between the sections was not statistically significant. But to share with you the results here, to assess curiosity, I asked students to respond to the following statements. The readings in this class motivate me to read more about different topics. If I find something interesting in class, I read more about it. In all of these slides, the blue is the health section, and the red and the green are the two literature-only sections.
What's the difference between one and two?
The questions, or literature in one and literature two. It's the two different sections. I wanted to separate them out because there could be other factors that affect student responses rather than putting them together, right? At what time the course was offered or who the instructor was or anything like that. So literature one is one section and literature two is a different section.
Just a different section. Okay.
To assess their emotional investment, I had them respond to the statements, the readings in this class are interesting to me personally, and I enjoy the readings in this class. To assess preference for a challenge, they responded to the statements, I enjoy putting time into thinking about the readings in this class, and I enjoy reading the challenging texts in this class.
Why would you think there's such a difference between lit one and two? Since they're just simply two different sections, right?
There was one section where the instructor had a, it seemed like it was the dynamic of the specific group of students who were harder than that instructor had had before. That instructor was experiencing more frustration with that group of students than the instructor had in previous times, so that could be. But I have no...
So it was the dynamics of the
classroom. Yeah, it could have been the dynamics. So
what was the N again for each of the groups?
11, 8, and 12.
It's
11,
small,
very small. So yeah. Blue was 11, red was 8, and green was 12. And I am showing them in percentage of responses rather than straight numbers because I think that...
This makes no sense. That
otherwise, you wouldn't be able to compare them. And the one question regarding intrinsic motivation that I asked them to respond to was, I am learning things that will help me in my future work life. And interestingly, they were much closer on this, so that the students in the literature only were feeling that they were learning life skills as well.
That's sort of counterintuitive in a way.
It is counterintuitive, yeah. Where the Kruskal-Wallis H test did show a statistically significant difference was in the students' expression of their attitude toward course enrollment and the requirement, as represented in the statement, I would take this class even if it were not required for the major. And in this case, the health students agreed more strongly with the statement than the literature-only students. The mean ranks, for those who do statistics, the mean ranks of enrollment attitude scores were statistically significantly different between the groups, with chi-squared being 7.801 and the p-value being 0.02.
So this is also more intrinsic motivation.
What is?
I think
this
it shows also, it shows more motivation from the part of the students. I'll take it even though it doesn't matter for my
my
degree.
I agree with you. I want to think about this. In all of these cases, I am redoing the study this semester on three more sections, and I have enriched the number of questions and the way things are asked, and we'll see what happens. And I'm not teaching any of them this time, so it's also a test of when someone else takes over this course.
I think this is kind of interesting because all the other medical Spanish courses are electives and not required.
Mm-hmm.
And that kind of show
that's
up the same mm-hmm. the same approach. You know,
that's
they are taken even though it is, I will take it if not required.
In addition to the survey, the project assistant, Cynthia Arellanos, led a focus group discussion. I did not attend so that students would feel free to express their honest opinions. I also did not require attendance, and the attendance was very low. I will end this presentation by sharing a few comments made by the four students who did participate in the focus group, as they add to my optimism that this course is the right direction to take. Their responses address both sides of the interdisciplinary bridge, the commitment to engaging our students in a humanistic approach to literature on the one hand, and on the other, the commitment to explicitly linking the study of literature to human transformations that might enable our students to become better health providers. The students in the focus group were asked what texts they had most enjoyed. Three of the four of them said the poetry. That surprised me. They explained that the poetry allowed space for interpretation and made them think more. All four said that the poems had been most important in helping them to develop critical thinking skills. They mentioned the need to identify metaphors, images, and symbols, to take a very brief text and find its deeper meaning. Tienes que estar muy atento. Cada palabra hace una gran diferencia. El orden de las palabras, la palabra en sí. Preguntarse por qué no usaron otra palabra. In talking about the course units, the students volunteered their appreciation for considering different perspectives on experiences of health, illness, and healthcare. They talked about how perspective is molded by upbringing and culture. These were all freely given. I hadn't prompted them. That was what they got out of the course. They talked, one student thinks differently now about people living with disability after seeing and discussing the movie Gabi, a true story about a Mexican woman whose cerebral palsy severely limited her physical movements and her ability to communicate, but did not limit her self-advocacy and her activism for disability rights. Another student who works in a clinic mentioned learning that it is important to take into account a patient's emotions and not only their physical complaint. The film Mar Adentro moved one student to consider carefully the character's differing views on assisted suicide. Entiendo que lo que quiere Ramón es morir, pero si te pones en los zapatos del sobrino, es diferente. In these responses, I hear the students appreciating literature for its own sake and recognizing how their study of literary and other cultural texts has opened up their thinking and encouraged them to pay more attention to detail and to perspective and to question their prior positions. Thanks to a leave funded by the College of Arts and Sciences, I am collaborating with my friend and colleague Jill Kuhnheim of the University of Kansas and now of Brown University on a textbook for the course, a book that could be also used for advanced electives and even in medical schools. Our tentative title is Para Vivir con Salud, Leyendo la Salud y la Literatura. And finally, I continue to study how this course affects students' reading motivation, their text comprehension and analytical writing, and importantly, their enrollment in advanced literature courses. Thank you. And
good job. Would you cross-list it with the medical school's curricula?
I'm not proposing to cross-list this course with the medical school because it is a 300 level, but there is interest among the faculty to develop 400 level classes focused on, Eleuterio Santiago Diaz teaches a plague as metaphor mm-hmm. course, and Jeremy Lehman is interested in doing something. I'm trying to remember what the specific topic was and I can't, but I think I haven't made all the contacts. We need to talk about whether, I don't know what the medical school here is doing in terms of humanities preparation. I know there's
probably
a narrative. There is a narrative medicine journal that has been published by the
David
medical students.
Yeah, Medical News and
David was doing something.
Yeah, and it is it used to be part of PIN, and it's the PIN is Prospective in Medicine, and it's the writing part of PI, it's practical immersions that medical students go in the rural New Mexico between the first and the second year, and they have to do narrative medicine.
So I talked about what my students in a literature course got out of the representation. Other things that in a medical school the representation does is to allow the students to reflect on their own practice and to allow others to help them figure out problematic moments in the interpretation. When I went to the narrative medicine workshop at Columbia last fall, we were read what was clearly a gynecological exam of some a situation, of a procedure, and it was very interesting to hear how the verbs that the medical student used began with active verbs and subjects, the people were present, and then when things started to get difficult and the student was, the patient was experiencing pain, all of a sudden it went into the passive voice. And so you could see how another student or a supervisor could look at that and see, say, okay, let's think about what happened exactly at this point. Why did you, were you unable to recognize subjectivity at that point?
You would distance yourself. Yeah.
Well, that's a coping mechanism. There's a lot, you know, what we do in Amrit, in the neck, you know. This is focused on your experience, but what happened in the narrative medicine class is exactly that, you know, and that's part of the process of going back to, you know, empathy, compassion, altruism, and that happened in each encounter, and in each encounter you have those mix of emotions and that come from, you know, from the being, they're there because they're not at ease, they have a disease.
Yeah.
And so that unease creates that those emotions that are positive and negative. And part of the challenge of a clinical encounter is learn how to decodify, you know, one, the symptoms, and the narrative of the health awareness process. What is the unbalance that is causing the illness?
Doesn't it seem as if it would be a step in the right direction for the department to do this, given what you said about the trend in the country, where, you know, humanities and medicine are coming closer together? It just seems as if that would be really a good step for the Spanish department at UNM, right, to promote.
That's what this course is about.
Right.
Trying to pull together.
Right.
You know,
I think it's not new that humanities are
named
to medicine. This is the symptoms that are not happening is part of the revolucionismo científico, but part of, you know, from the history of medicine, in order to be, you know, from the time of Hippocrates to the Greeks, to the Romans, to the Egyptians, you know, you have to be able to have an holistic approach. If you look at it from, you know, Chinese medicine has Native American medicine, you know, the medicine of Latin, you know, the Central America with the Incas or the Mayas or the South, you know, or the Mapuches in the South, they all have to do with the integration and balance. And so try to separate that and compartmentalize and say that, you know, medicine is not that doesn't need a humanistic formation. Having a very narrow view.
You could also integrate part of the curanderas. And because they are, I mean, they have some medical background and there's different levels. And I think this, Veronica, remember when the state was doing a program for the curanderas to teach them more medicine.
Yeah. And Cheo Torres teaches
part of
curanderismo
that
course that
right.
does count for students. Students can take that for credit.
But it also, but they started with, it's like the midwife. I mean, they knew everything about the patient. It wasn't so much that they could cure this or that,
mm-hmm.
but a lot of times just talking, you know, and they could figure out, you know, what was wrong in this patient's life. And I would suggest that that course in Curandismo,
yes, the narrative is healing, you know, just telling the story of the illness process is a healing process, you know.
Yes.
You know, right.
This is not just like why we go with, you know, that's the base of all the mental
There's
health.
A systemic issue, though, and that is the way medicine is practiced today,
right,
with the visits being, you know, a new patient visit is maybe 20 minutes, maybe if you're lucky.
If you talk slow.
Exactly, and the doctor's looking at the computer, putting it on.
Right. I think there's another.
So that's I think that's something to think about
yeah.
How do you pull this off and have the physician be the kind of physician we want him or her to be?
So my answer to what you're saying is institutionally, and that is what I'm trying to do with this course, is bring together in the department these two dialogues. Into this, as Dr. Plaza has shown, this medical humanities is not new.
No.
And so, pull it together. And I thank you, graduate students, I thank you so much for coming. I hope that there would be a graduate student audience, because I want you to be able to think about this as for your careers and the situations you go into. So,
thank you.
Sorry, I was late, but it was another event on our campus
the
next day.
I don't know if my email sent. I sent an email for the override. I might have made this piece of to you.